it's nice to be here with you again. And I want to say, this is a sort of sequel of the lecture I gave last year in Split. And today I will try to extend the talk to the question of information theory. So if I can use board. So if you talk about the information theory, then let's put it like this. We have a source. We have something we could call communication channel. And let's say we have a destination. Let's put it, it's something related to information theory. What does it mean? From the very beginning, that means we are dealing with, let's say, a discrete random variable or just a set of symbols. With certain assigned probabilities. Through the communication channel to be delivered to the destination, where due to the, let's say, noise in the system, we will have another discrete random variable, another set of symbols, with another probability. So this is, I would say, completely mathematical structure. In electrical engineering, we have a signal theory. That means we deal with input. That could be, let's say, voltage or current or whatever you want. Then we have what we call in electrical engineering transfer function. For example, impedance or admittance or so on. And then we have output. So, in a frequency domain, that would be x in the function of f. This would be transfer function. And this is the output. In a frequency domain, the relationship is very simple. It's just a multiplication of the input with the transfer function. If you go to time domain, it's a bit complicated because you have input response instead of transfer function, and you have output in a function of time, input in a function of time, and you will have, instead of this, you will have what we call convolution. Which is mathematically a bit complicated, but let's put it in its complete form. Okay, so what I really want is to somehow connect this with electromagnetics, because in the same reality we have actually on a lower physical, or let's say fundamental physical level, we have a transmitter. This is the antenna. Then, this transfer function or communication channel will be electromagnetic wave interacting with environment, which is actually related to this noise. And on the other side of this communication system, of course, we have another antenna, and we will have a receiver. So somehow I must correlate this with the communication theory, or theory of communication channel, or information theory. In engineering, it's more and more important these days. I mean, a few international groups dealing with some aspects of the new generation of mobile communication, you know, it's so-called 5G, Internet of Things, and so on. So the question is how to somehow enlarge the communication channel, how to maximize capacity in order to actually obtain all of these functions which are guaranteed by the 5G. Okay, so So let's see the contents of the talk. So first I would like to go to the some fundamentals or let's say basic aspects of electromagnetics. Then I will try to say a few words about this transmitter or source in a sense of talk related to electromagnetic radiation sources. What is really important for this is a fundamental theory of energy conservation in the electromagnetic field. It's a Poynting theorem and a Poynting power flow. And then we will switch to the elements of information theory. So finally, in the concluding remarks, I will try to somehow connect these aspects from the physical basis to the classical terms of Shannon information theory, which is actually implicitly correlated, but some, let's say, more serious approach and more papers are coming in the last decade in this regard. Okay, so I will repeat some parts of the lecture of last year. Of course, we will start from Maxwell equations. So the Maxwell equations completely define the world of classical electromagnetic fields. We have four differential equations, which implicitly actually contain the necessity of the existence of electromagnetic waves. So the first equation simply says that time-varying magnetic induction gives rise to the electric field. In the second Maxwell equations, we have actually a differential form of generalized Ampere's law stating that time-varying electric flux density gives rise to magnetic fields. And the last two equations are related to sources. So third Maxwell equation simply says that electric monopoles may exist, and in classical electromagnetics there are no monopoles. So it's very simple to derive the electromagnetic wave equations for the quantity of interest from the Maxwell equations. So you can do it for the electric field, magnetic field, or you can do it for the magnetic vector potential. So it's interesting when you solve wave equations, there are two solutions. One is called retarded potential, and the other one is called the advanced potential. This one is used in electrical engineering, and the second one is said to be non-physical, because here the consequence precedes the cause. But it's possible, of course, to establish the theory by using either one and others. And last year and 2 years ago, I was talking about this, so I will not go to the details. Just to emphasize that if we have a delay, time delay, at the observation point with respect to the source, that is something which is related to the retarded potential. And in most of the, in almost all of the electrical engineering or electromagnetics textbooks, this second option is simply omitted. Okay, so where does it go to? Actually, by this defining the retarded potential, somehow we introduce the radiation error of time. If we have radiation error of time, actually we have a time error, and we have the entropy coming into the stage, and it's not a problem to connect this with the thermodynamic entropy. Something I talked about last year. So conservation law for the energy stored in the electric and magnetic fields in the certain volume V is expressed by pointing theorem. So it simply says that sources within a volume are related to the energy which is accumulated in either electric or magnetic field. That could be energy which is accumulated in the electric field in the capacitor, or let's say in a coil in the form of magnetic field. This second term on the right hand side is related to the losses. The losses means if we have the electric current, let's say flowing around the antenna, then anything that goes to heat is related to this term, this J is. And here we have the flow of the energy, or less the power flow out of the volume, it's related to radiation. So, interesting things is if we want to do the equivalence with the mechanical quantities, we can do it. So we can have, let's say, electromagnetic mass, we can have the electromagnetic force, the electromagnetic pressure, and so on and so forth. What is interesting with the pointing theorem that it's useful to split in a frequency domain the real part and the imaginary part. Then the real part of the pointing theorem is related to the sources and losses, and the imaginary part is dealing with the oscillation of the power in the near field. Okay, so Stefan Boltzmann was something I talked about last year, so we just write down the first law of thermodynamics, and we use the electromagnetic energy density, which is arising from a pointing theorem, and after a little bit of playing in mathematics, we come to the usual quote of Stefan Boltzmann. Okay, so this is the basis. This is the basis in the sense of classical electromagnetic theory. Now we go to the second part, which is related to the description of a transmitter or description of source. So, actually, what is the source of electromagnetic radiation? The source of electromagnetic radiation, physically speaking, is accelerated charge. If we talk about the microscopic approach, but with the non-relativistic velocities. If you go to something which is a more, let's say, convenient in engineering, we deal with the macroscopic approach. So instead of playing with charges and charged particles, we used to deal with current density. So somehow we impose the integral equation, starting from Maxwell equation, we impose the so-called integral equation for the unknown current. So this is the basis of all classical electromagnetics in a sense of electromagnetic radiation. The point is that this current along the antenna is unknown, and to solve this we have to deal with the solution of integral equation, which is actually, just to make it simple, we transfer the integral equation into the matrix equation, and we can solve the system of equation to get the approximative solution. So we do that, and for example, this is the current along the antenna for a different antenna lens. Okay. But let's go to the basics and to start with the simplest radiation source, which is Hertz dipole. So Hertz dipole, it's possible actually to get the analytical solution for the electromagnetic field. So why is it important for this issue? Because the solution of the Hertz dipole for the unit value of voltage actually will correspond to something I call transfer function. And this transfer function, which corresponds to this equation, is very important to compute the signal power density. And signal power density is important for something in theory or information which is related to the channel capacity, which I will address later on. Okay, so by using this radius of electric and magnetic field, I can compute the actually pointing flow. And finally, by knowing the incident power density, I can finally address the signal theory. Just one simple relation. So in signal theory, actually, if you have the spectrum, you can compute this power by integrating all the spectral density. So just to let you know how it looks like from the measuring device, this is some spectral spectral content, and these are the mathematical approximation. Okay, finally, elements of information here. So it was posed by Claude Shannon. I remember that Tim was talking about it last year. Unfortunately, this year I didn't participate in his lecture. But actually, it refers to the basic problem in communication to reproduce a message sent from a source to the receiver. So, what is a message in engineering sense? Let's say it's a sequence of symbols chosen from certain alphabet X generated by source, and this is a simply set of these values. So this can be regarded as a discrete random variable. So any of this symbol is assigned its corresponding probability for being chosen. So very, very simple for the beginning. Okay, so due to the noise during the message transfer process, this sequence of symbol at the input are delivered to the, let's say, destination, but at the destination there is another sequence of symbols, let's say Y, from the set of a new discrete random variable, and any of these values has its own probability. Maybe I can does this like? So, let's say we have input or source. So, X1. X1, X2, Xi, and Xm, Xm. Okay. On the other side of the information system, we have this. Probability P of XI. So at the input, there is a possibility that any of these symbols is detected. Any of them. So what we have here? We have X, which is chosen, but given the Y1 is detected of the source. Here we will have P of XI and epsilon 2 and so on. And the same could be written. I don't have enough colors, but okay, but just we can have detected symbol epsilon y2, and the question of the probabilities, which was the original message. Epsilon 2, provided epsilon, and so on. So this is the initial problem. Actually, this is the initial Shannon's problem with the delivering of messages. Okay, so where does it go to? Now we are talking about the communication problem. So on the basis of the appearance of a certain symbol YJ at the receiver, we need to conclude which symbol, X, I, is chosen at the source. Provided we have the statistical properties of the communication systems, the probability of appearance of each YJ caused by X, I is known. So this is the basic idea. So let's go, what can we do in this regard from now on? Okay, so, as I actually emphasize here. Now, we deal with the conditional probability of detecting YJ at the output provided XI is delivered from the source. So, what we do need is a measure of the quantity of information received in the message. Of interest is how much information is stored in each message symbol. And this measure, according to Shannon, is referred to as average information content. And now our chimera comes to the stage. So what is entropy? Entropy can be regarded as a measure of information content or measure of information source uncertainty. So there are plenty of different information, for example, it's a measure of a random variable uncertainty, a surprise of a given outcome observed, or a measure of delivered information in the observed process. And here is the famous definition, which is actually, I would say, mathematical convenience, and nothing more. Why mathematical convenience?
I'm used to have a chalk and the blackboard, so.
So why logarithm?
Let's say we have a famous cube with six numbers. So what is the probability if we have six possible events? Or let's say n possible events. So the probability, of course, of any of these events is 1 over n. If we have twice, then the probability. So, any combination xi and yj, we all know it's a multiplication of this. Okay, so the entropy or information content, of course, is a summation of both. So logarithm, as we know, of the product is equal to the logarithm, to the sum of logarithms. So this fact and this fact with the probability, of course, actually is the reason why in communication theory, or let's say information theory, we have such a definition. Okay, so we are still away from this. Oh, I erased it. From the electromagnetism, because in electromagnetics we have continuous variables, so this is just the beginning of the story. And we go on with mathematics with some definitions, but the point is we just play with, let's say, this fundamental, this basic definition. So, this is something called joint entropy of two random variables. Then we have conditional entropy, defined as the average of a random variable y, given x is known, average of all values, both variable x. So, let's say conditional entropy of variable y with respect to x yields average uncertainty for variable y, which remains once the variable x is known. The same could be done, of course, the other way around with these variables, and we just arrive to the, let's say, content of information. We're going to define, so the mutual information between random variables x and y is defined as relative entropy. Actually, we have ratio between joint probabilities and product of individual probabilities. So, there are lots of this relation related to the mutual information and the entropy of one variable, other variable, the conditional entropy, which is quite visible here, and maybe we can take a look at this definition. So maybe I can draw it here. It's easier to follow up. Okay, so what does this say? The mutual information is equal to the entropy of random variable x, random variable I, minus joint entropy. So, it's easy. So this is the entropy of variable x. And okay, plus variable epsilon, and minus this component. So we obtain what is defined, and this joint entropy is actually the surface of these two circles. Okay, so now we come to the engineering problem. What is the channel capacity? For example, maybe I can ask the audience questions. Do you know what is the frequency spectrum which is required to deliver the acoustic signal?
Like, you're talking, 3D air?
Yeah.
20
Yeah, okay, it's maximum, but what is the minimum to have a normal communication between whom? It's around 4 kilohertz. So that's something you need in a sense of a channel capacity to transmit acoustic signal. Do you know about the video signal? Video signal, 5 to 7 megahertz. So, if we want to submit more and more information, actually we are devoted really to somehow enlarge the channel capacity to put it on its maximum level. Okay, so the channel capacity is defined as maximal delivered information content, and actually given some constraint in the sense of a particular channel, noise, characteristic of the channel, and constraint of the available power, this is the definition of the channel capacity. Okay. And now the final stuff. So if I want to somehow connect the electromagnetic and my transmitting antenna, which is actually what physically existing, if I want to submit information, I'm dealing with a continuous variables. So we cannot talk anymore with discrete sets. Now we are dealing with a continuous random variable. So instead of probability, actually in if I have a discrete random variable, then I have a set, okay, like this, xi and probability p of xi. But if my random variable is continuous, then I have continuous random variable, and I also have probability density function. I mean the, let's say, equivalent of this discrete motion into this continuous world. So you can observe this here, it's just an extension of this definition. So here we are dealing with a differential entropy, and actually it appears that this, which is well known from statistics, this definition, this differential entropy, is actually first statistical moment for mean, no means, mean or expectance. Okay, so we can have the continuous variable at the input, continuous variable at the output. We can have joint entropy also, so we are dealing with now with a continuous random variable, actually continuous random variable of x and y, and we have from the mathematics the definition of these probability density functions f1 and f0, which are related just dependence of x and dependence of y in this particular way. And of course, differential mutual information has its own definition in this integral, and also the conditional differential entropy. So this conditional differential entropy can be considered as the uncertainty that remains, regarding uncertainty of the outcome is this is x and this is y. I have PDF, so I didn't make a correction. If we go epsilon x, epsilon, epsilon x, then would be epsilon nx. So it's just typing here. Okay, so how to maximize the entropy of a continuous random variable? It appears that Gaussian random variable will maximize the capacity of the channel because of its properties, so we can compute this. And through the mathematics, we come up with interesting channel relation, where the differential mutual information of the continuous variables, if we assume the signal with the information which is attacked by the noise, and this is the output value. This noise we used to call additive noise, because we can define this as the sum of these two variables. And this is the first interesting Shannon results, where we have differential mutual information in terms of this ratio of signal and noise. But it's not the complete story, because we always have a constraint. What does it mean to have a constraint? Your power is actually limited. So you have, let's say, the given power available at input or at the source, and the capacity of the Shannon channel, being the supremo of the mutual information, is related to this relation. Okay, now we can talk about parallel channels, and finally, what is interesting, the band-limited Gaussian channel, where we have the bandwidth of two frequencies, and finally, we come to something which could be related to electromagnetics, and this is related to this formula of the channel capacity, where this is the spectral density of the signal, which is related then to the incident power density of the antenna radiated at the transmitter. This is the noise spectral density, and speaking in a form of electromagnetics, which is, let's say, under construction or ongoing research in my group, is the channel capacity of the electromagnetic signal can be obtained by maximizing the expression, where this transfer function is taken from the Green's function of the electromagnetic field radiated from the Hertz dipole. This is the noise, and the total available power actually impresses this constraint. So this could be solved by so-called method of Lagrange multipliers, and we can obtain the channel capacity. Okay, so I hope I didn't take too much time. What I wanted to say is as follows. So the information theory is well defined, the electromagnetic theory is well defined. Their interconnection is about to be worked out, but we can say physical and engineering concepts of classical electromagnetics mathematically well understood and completely understood, well established. I said almost completely understood, because there are always some problems which are not completely resolved. Some entropy aspects of classical electromagnetics related correlation and thermodynamic entropy is already, let's say, well understood. As I already mentioned, information theory entropy concept, I would say, are mathematically well defined. But what is our task now in my group? Engineering applications of electromagnetics and information theory as one, let's say, merged theory or approach. Correlation is important, and numerous applications are really coming along with 5G technology. But what is important for this meeting, and what is the idea for discussion, is what about physical and philosophical aspects for information theory and entropy concepts? Are they related? Is it just the same name, same mathematical tool, or just, let's say, something which is a useful concept in electrical engineering? Actually, Shannon was an engineer. Is it just a convenient tool for something to be resolved by engineers, or is it really something which is understood by the very basic concept? So thank you for your attention, and I hope we can have a nice discussion in this regard.
Let me ask the question you have at the bottom.
Yeah.
In a slightly different tone of voice. right, so the Shannon entropy and the mutual entropy, the information theoretic concepts are perfectly fine in themselves for the purposes of the
universe. Yes.
And if you're using an electromagnetic wave, you have certain issues. Like I said, it's not really a discrete system, which is sort of what you start out analyzing, so you have to deal with that. And also, there's limits to how fast you can make the thing vibrate, and the power limits and things like that that have to be taken into account. But it wasn't, I have been from the beginning of this rather skeptical that there's any deep or systematic connection between that and thermodynamic entropy. The other applications of entropy, or von Neumann entropy, these other applications of something where you have, you have low wall row, you have this sort of common mathematical structure, but it's not clear that that's not enough to tell you that they're deeply, physically entropic. And I'm sure you have to deal with thermodynamic issues as an engineer. But do you find that the information theoretic concepts intersect with the thermodynamic ones, or are you just sort of dealing with them separately?
Yeah.
As an expert, what's your
experience? We were talking about it yesterday, and this is the only link I see. Mm-hmm. So. I like the sentence, information is physical. Because to deliver information, you need signals. So signals is actually physical medium where the information is incorporated. So actually the trick or the answer would be, if the information is physical, then to put any kind of information content, you need a memory. And sooner or later, this memory could be full. And sooner or later, you will have to empty this memory, you will have to erase it. The action of erasing a memory will somehow generate heat.
Okay.
And this is the only...
That's the only place.
This is the only link I can see. But...
Wait.
Let me just let Wayne go,
there's always a lot to say, so very quickly. I may have mentioned this last time, but it is impressive to me. You say information is physical, and you say, I have an actual information transmitting system, it's a physical system, it's physical properties. But there's this example that I always like, which is from Sherlock Holmes, of the dog that didn't bark in the night, right? So there's a somebody steals the horse, silver blaze, very valuable horse, and Sherlock Holmes has to figure out who did it. And the key to him figuring it out is that the dog that's where the horse is didn't bark. And so he says, the thief must have been someone of the household, a familiar person, or the dog would have barked. Now, the non-barking of the dog and the quiescence of the air
is information for people.
It's transmitting information, even though there's nothing physical, right? The way the information is transmitted depends on the structure of what would have happened. Right, not just what did happen, but what
happened.
So there you have information transmission with no energy transmission, with no intuitively no physical transmission, because things would have been different.
But he was processing. Yes.
Had things been different at the
time. But he was processing the thought.
Sure, he was thinking.
The same thing with the Sherlock Holmes example is why, if I tried to design a communication channel, actually look at not just what happens on any given signal, but the average properties. So if I were wanted to design a communication channel between the dog and Sherlock Holmes, I would need something capable of transmitting energy.
Yes.
Even if one of the things is nothing happens.
That, right.
Yeah, I think that's right.
Right.
And I think, I was struck with the fact the only time you mentioned anything thermodynamic was when you're talking about fuel heat loss, power loss by 3D. Yeah, I think we'd be better off if Shannon had not taken Glenn Lemon's suggestion and adopted the term entropy. Expected information.
We
would all be much, much better off.
You see, entropy has nice properties.
It's
mathematical.
It is true that the Gibbs entropy and the Shannon information take the same mathematical form. So if you prove a bunch of theorems about one, then they transfer over to the other. That's nice, right? But and so there is a sense in which they are more closely related than pizza, certainly Roman pizza, certainly pizza. But really, it's just two different things.
Yeah. I agree. I could agree. Thank you.
Okay.